questions, if you can wait for the microphone because we are broadcasting live. So, over to Ed.
Sorry, yes. Well, I've done this a few times, but I've never been nervous, really, and I am. And that's not because Sandra is a stranger. I'm lucky to count her among my friends as well as colleagues. But just the sheer quality and caliber of what we are dealing with and talking about. You know, Millicent knows we've had, you know, we've had some brave, compelling, interesting, and extraordinary people sitting up here over the years, and a few boring ones too, to be honest, between friends. How to begin to introduce Sandra Rodríguez? And I think the best way to do so is simply to say that Sandra was on the crime beat of El Diario de Ciudad Juárez during the years that it was the murder capital of the world. And one of her colleagues was Armando Rodriguez, no relation, but close friend and dear colleague. it may sound sort of pretentious or even pompous to dedicate our gatherings at this club. If we did it all the time, it would be both of those things, but this isn't, and I'd like to, you know, for those of you here and those on the web listening, welcome to you all, dedicate this to the memory and family of Armando Rodriguez, who was brutally and horribly murdered for doing the work that Sandra was also doing. And in being thus executed by whoever, be it the army, the police, the cartels, or all of the above, which is probable, he becomes, I think, you know, in this of all places, a sort of a press-ish club, a kind of a symbol of our profession at its most sort of noble in a way, but it's more complicated, it's more vernacular than that. When we read about the mass murder of journalists that we're going to talk about later with Sandra in Mexico, it's not actually the people, I hope, like, you know, myself or Tracy Wilkinson of the LA Times, blah, blah, blah. It is the local reporters on the crime beat. They are the 87 or so reporters who've been murdered, often brutally and very rarely quickly. So Sandra worked with Armando on Diario. Just two little things, brief points, well, big things, but I'll say them briefly because you're not here to listen to me for sure. When we discuss what's happening in Mexico, in terms of warfare, this is supposed to be an institution devoted to war reporting above all, I mean, the numbers, 120,000 killed, something like 20,000 missing, in a country where people go on holiday to the Yucatan, in a country where our oil companies are looking busily to invest, quote unquote, the most repulsive word in the language. We'll get to all that later. But that's one thing. But it's not a distant place. It's not a distant carnage. It's ours. European noses, American noses, snorting the coke. It may even be the spliff that you go back to enjoy tonight. That's why it's happening. And every time you look up at Canary Wharf and you see the letters HSBC, don't worry, legal department, they've admitted it, that's the bank, the financial wing of the Sinaloa cartel, which we like to call the largest criminal organization in the world. How criminal does that make HSBC? Well, not sufficient to send a single one of them to jail when they get caught moving the money. This book is extraordinary, and it comes, it's interesting because we've had, there's been two this year. This is absolutely cheek by jowl. This is Sandra, who, as she's quoted as saying in a Mexico, my humble effort, literally going out at night on her own, in her car, remember, right, wondering, now, who is this man I've agreed to meet? Why am I doing this? And for scores of our colleagues, this has been the last thing they ever did. But you did it, and you've done it, and now you're writing about it, even though they've tried to stop you doing so. Cheek by jowl. And my wider point is this. There was another book recently come out called 000 by Roberto Saviano, And he writes his from the other end of the lens, if you like. Condemned to distance and 24 hour, 7 days a week under bodyguard. And in that book, he says, why do we do this? And we're going to ask Sandra that. He says two things. One is because you do not understand the world unless you understand narco-traffic. If you don't understand narco-traffic, you don't understand the global economy. And he said in that book that there was a time when cocaine had to follow the logic of the market. Now the market has to follow the logic of cocaine. So enough of me. Yes, I think I've said all I need to say. Ciudad Juárez, let's begin with your city. Well, it's not your city, actually. There's a terrible irony is that Sandra left Mexico City to go and live in Juárez because she thought Mexico City was too dangerous.
Now I'm living in Mexico City.
Thank goodness for that. Well, we'll talk about Rubén Esposa later on. Can you set the scene for us? Ciudad Juárez, on the border.
Right.
Mid-60s. The maquiladoras.
Right.
Little guide to your city. We've got time, so.
It is this border town that was based in the agriculture economy, but in the 60s, there is a group of politicians that agreed to have this model of foreign investment coming to the city and starting the industrialization of the city, what we call maquiladoras. You might have heard of this term. And this, after the NAFTA, maybe from 90s to the 2000, the maquiladoras were so attractive and the country so poor that became the industrial capital in the country. It was the city with the biggest amount of people working in this kind of maquiladoras, like
assembly plants for kind
assembly
of
assembly plants, exactly.
And so
right, factories of cars, parts, etc., etc. And so the city doubled its population in 10 years, from 700,000 to 1.5 million, around that. And what I think is the tragedy of the city is that there was so much people coming to the city, which is good, but the government didn't pay any attention to the fact that these people need not just a place to work, but a place to live, and schools, and daycare centers for kids, etc. So they didn't do anything about that. They not even pave the streets. So half of the city has no pavement. And these people is forced to live in these conditions. And at the beginning, we thought, oh, this is great. There's so much money going on. I mean, everybody has a job. But there were a lot of things going on as well during the 90s. At the same time, we were focused on the maquiladora economy, but at the same time, there were this organized crime running, ruling the city, and it was growing and growing and growing. And during the 90s, I remember, I'm from Chihuahua, which is the state capital. And I moved for college to Juarez in the 90s. And I remember everything became like more chaotic. Like there were a lot of people and not enough houses, not enough schools, and not even enough streets, so it was a total mess. But what was the symptom that something really heavy was going on? It was that the killing of women started in 1993 around. We started to see in the news, they found a dead woman in the dust or in the desert, and then they found five, then they found four or eight. And at the same time, we start to listen stories about disappearance of guys. Like, I remember a friend of mine in college, she one day said, you know, somebody kidnapped my brother. It's not for ransom, they just took him away. But during those years, we certainly believed that, okay, this is not my problem. This is gonna sound awful, but I'm sure that we all were like, women are being killed because they are poor. They use public transportation. They are really exposed. And guys are being disappeared because they might be in the drug trafficking. So we kind of accepted this for years and years and years and years, and we let all the things as they were, and we never, as a society, I think we never felt compelled to ask for justice. It was like, no, it's not my problem. And after 20 years of this, no wonder, I mean, we just need like a war on drugs or two groups fighting, and there were like thousands of kids willing to carry a gun and be employed as sicarios, etc. But it was this mix of an economy based in the idea that the people may have a job and they may eat. If they cannot send the kids to the school, well, that's fine. But they are buying shoes, they are going to the movie theaters, they are spending money. And we never really care about the society that we were building in. And I think that's the foundation of many of the things that we saw in the recent years.
At what point did you and Armando and others and your colleagues on the paper realize that you were dealing with these sort of these institutions of vast and terrifying power? I mean, first of all, the Juarez cartel, then the Sinaloa cartel, then the Mexican army, and the this sort of mesh between the army, the police, and the state, and their various relationships with them. I mean, when did it become clear that you were?
Well, it took some. I think we all realized it in different times. I mean, it was not like there was an announcement that the city is going through this, but we realized it differently in different times. For me, it was maybe after Armando's killing, when I realized that it was something really, really, really enormous.
Is that the anniversary of which, seventh anniversary, by which is tomorrow, by the way. Seventh anniversary.
Right. Of impunity. But during the 2007, maybe, there was, Armando knew before. Armando knew in advance, and he was like, you know, there's going to be like a big fight for the territory, and the state attorney knew, a lot of people kind of knew, because after Calderon took office, they said, we are gonna send the army over these places, but, and actually I interviewed the Ministry of the Interior, and he said, we're gonna send the army and we're gonna declare no war, but like a confrontation against cartel. And I really thought, this is against the bad guys. I never thought that it was going to be like this blur lines where you don't know what's going on. And I think this because we were used to the idea that it was just among them, and we were super indifferent to what was happening before that. But I really, really never thought that it was going to be so long.
What's extraordinary about this book is that, well, many things, but there are some wonderful Mexican reporters on the crime beat, and they are brave and they work hard, but they couldn't write a book necessarily. I mean, what Sandra's done here is a book with really two extraordinary literary devices that make it a piece of literature and reportage, not journalism, as well as journalism. It's called, in Spanish it's called La Fábrica del Crimen, the crime factory, which is how I first came to know it. It's the story of Vicente, who murdered his mother, his father, and his sister. Well, you might think, well, I don't need to read the book now, but you do. Because the question is, why and who is Vicente? And what Sandra does here, and this isn't a sort of literary book club, but it needs saying, is takes this case of this boy, and he's an interesting boy. He's, as Sandra points out, interestingly, towards the beginning, he's one of the very few children in Juarez who's brought up by both parents.
Right.
And later on, when he's in jail, we find him requesting Wuthering Heights and a biography of Bertrand Russell to read, along with other books. I mean, this is no ordinary kid from the barrio. But he is he commits this fratricidal murder. What's it, murdering a sister? Sostricidal? Anyway, whatever. Kills a sister as well.
Parasite.
I think both fratricidal. Anyway, let's not get bogged down with that. But what Sandra does is weaves this story in thematically and in terms of narrative with the story of what happens in Juarez and ultimately the takeover of the city by the Sinaloa cartel in alliance with the authorities. That's the shorthand. We'll get to the details later. But there's also, of course, the story of Armando Rodriguez covering the story as part of the narrative. And we'll get onto the prisons chapters later, I think. But just because the book is called The Story of Vicente, who Vicente, why Vicente? Because you could have written yet another book about narco cartels, which I did rather tediously. Wow. But you've chosen this sort of, you know, it's really, yes, I'm not recommending the book, I'm insisting that you read this book. You're doing something very interesting with this boy and his story. Why and what happened?
Well, Vicente's story was very important to me after I interviewed him in prison after he killed his entire family. And I
thought, as one does.
There was a, he did it with the help of two other kids, which made the case more like he might be a kid with a, he might be a sociopath, but he convinced two other kids from very different backgrounds to do the same. And the three of them agree that killing a family was totally easy. So when a colleague of mine first interviewed one of the kids and he said, Vicente convinced us that it was going to be easy. When I read that, it was like, easy? I mean, what is in the mind of these kids? I mean, how come to kill three people is considered easy? What kind of society is this? So I went to interview him with two questions in mind. First is, how did you get the gun? Where? And how much did you pay, et cetera? And the second was, how come to kill three people is considered easy? And his answer was a revelation for me. When I asked him, okay, why did you think it was easy? And he said, because this is Juarez. Because we thought this is Mexico. Mexico is just corruption. And how many dead women are out there? And nobody does anything. So we were convinced that there might be some sort of investigation or question like this, but we were sure that nobody was going to do anything about this. His answer opened a new level of explanation of what's happening to the city. I thought, okay, we have a problem of violence, but it's not just this level. We have a problem of impunity. Sending the message that killing is easy, that killing is almost legal, that killing is normal. And these kids are internalizing this environment of impunity. And these kids are growing up with the idea that Juarez in Juarez, or translate that to Mexico, I mean, that in Mexico or in Juarez you can do whatever you want and get away with your crime. For me, that was very important. And I was living in Juarez then, but I thought, we don't know what, we really haven't understand what is really happening to the city. It's not just that they are killing people, it's that we are evolving, or not evolving, but the opposite, but we are turning into a society that allows crime and normalize violence in a very, very deep way. And well, after a lot of reporters went to Juarez to cover the story, after 2008, this is 4 years after I wrote the first story of Vicente, I was planning to write a book like about the city because I realized that I had a lot of answers to foreign reporters, for instance. They were like asking, what's going on here? And I thought, well, I have a story to tell. And I wanted to write this, like 10 different pieces, like 10 different stories. One is the Aztecas gang, or another
street gang.
Right, another of the other gang, another about the cartels, another about the impunity, another about the urban development, the economy. So I wanted to write like 10 different stories. But what I was investigating, and another was Vicente's story. And when I went to his, I'm gonna spoil the story, he was already killed. And I went to look to the archives of his story in prison, et cetera, and I learned that he became a gangster in prison. And a gang that was very, very unique for Juarez because they are called themselves artistic assassins. It's just a generation of very young kids from this that were born in this boom of the maquiladoras, and they were really talented, like painters and et cetera, but they became gangsters. And they called themselves artistic assassins. That's when I realized, okay, Vicente is holding all these stories himself. He may be part of the gangster story, might be part of the cartel. I mean, he is the story of the city. He holds himself. His story holds a lot of explanations that I wanted to give, especially the fact that he killed because he thought that nobody was going to do anything about it.
I mean, there are two things, really. I mean, one is this idea of the power. I mean, the story of Vicente is the story of the brutalization of the city. And it's always difficult writing about Juarez because I find, for what it's worth, doing my effort at a book, the biggest challenge was to sort of make it bright and funny as well, because Juarez is, you know, the Juarenses are the friendliest, most hospitable, loveliest people you'll ever meet, and they are also the funniest. And so it's kind of, you know, always bear this in mind and never forget it, because if you don't get it into your writing, then you do them terrible injustice. But also it's the story of brutalization. There's a place called Riberas del Bravo, where I went with our mutual friend Julian Cardona, who I'm going to talk about later, where I remember the priest saying that he'd been burying a lot of these children recently, these murder children. So which murder? They're the children of women who, when they get a new husband or boyfriend, they agree to kill the kid from the old arrangement. It's sort of getting rid of the baggage of the past. That's what Vicente is, really. It's this sort of brutalized city. But it's also, when we met 6 years ago, you were thinking of calling your book Impunidad.
Right.
And you've actually come up with two better titles since, in Spanish and English. But in a way, that is another theme, isn't it? Impunity. Vicente thought, it's easy, I can get away with it. As it turned out, he was one of the very, 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 very few people who didn't get away with it. But this culture of impunity, I mean, let's get into the politics. Let's get into the driving theme of the second half of your book, which is when you realize that most of the people in jail with Vicente are all affiliated in one way or another to the old Juarez cartel or its kind of gangland affiliations. And the Sinaloa cartel is coming in, and somehow there don't seem to be many of them in jail, and there are these arrangements with the armed forces and the police. I mean, the impunity goes right to the top, doesn't it? And in a way, that's the other message of the book, isn't it, I think?
Right.
It's not just impunity for the people who kill their kids in Riberas del Bravo, or Vicente, if he had got away with it. There's a culture of what you were saying just now, of you know, the buck never stops with the killer. You get away with it. Isn't that the gist of it?
I'm sorry, I think I missed.
I'm sorry, that was me being asking. I mean, can you talk a bit about this culture of impunity? That it's not just Vicente thinking he can get away with
right,
it.
Right, right.
It's everybody thinking
right,
he can get away with it.
Right,
through the army, the police. It's like a sort of culture of impunity.
When I went to interview the criminologist, I mean, the head of the criminology department in prison, the official conclusion of Vicente's case was he cannot internalize rules. That's the official statement in his file. This kid cannot internalize rules because, I don't know how to say it in English, but the diagnostico, does anybody say diagnostico in English?
Diagnostic.
Diagnostic?
Prognostic, yeah, thank you.
Okay, the official diagnostic of his case was, it's an it's an external cause. It's not that he is as, the official diagnostic is, it's not inside of him. The criminologists, they have this like a way to classify criminals, and they say, why did this guy commit this crime? Well, maybe because he was abused when he was a child, maybe because it's an internal problem. And the official diagnostic of Vicente was, it's an external cause. He learned from outside that there were no rules at all. And when I interviewed the head of this department, the person that wrote that diagnostic, she said, unfortunately, that is the same case with thousands of kids that are getting in prison. They just cannot internalize rules. It's a society, it's like a scientific diagnostic. The kids in such an environment are growing up internalizing that rules doesn't exist at all. And they are like a new generation of kids in Mexico, I'm sure, growing, thinking that murder is almost legal and there are no rules at all. It's like an internalized thing. I mean, they are really, it's in the DNA.
What lesson is the leadership of society teaching in that regard? I mean, the generals, the police chiefs.
The president.
I mean, exactly. I mean, this goes right up to the top.
Yeah, corruption doesn't start in the bottom of the society. Corruption spreads from the top to the bottom. I mean, if the guy above you is corrupt, I mean, you're gonna learn. And the message is, if I can do it, you can do it. It's not the other way around. It's not like, oh, these guys are corrupt and I'm above them. If that is the case, you can stop that problem. But since it's spreading from the top to the bottom, I mean, no wonder why we have
it. It's endemic.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I always get wary of this. You know, here we are, we're all sitting in London talking about endemic corruption in Mexico. Can we just remind ourselves that HSBC was caught laundering the money? None of them went to jail either. This is us as well. It's not those brown people in Mexico, they're so corrupt and we're not. You know, just keep those four letters in mind when we're talking about corruption in Mexico.
Right.
Please.
It's not that we are the most corrupted country in the world. There is corruption everywhere. The thing is how you deal with corruption. I mean, or with murder. Mm. I mean, it's like in El Paso. We share the same environment, the same weather, the same territory, but the people and the same narcos actually, they live across the border as well. They launder the money as well. But when they want to kill, they do it in Juarez, because you cannot get away with a crime in El Paso. Just no, you don't kill and get away. Very rarely. But in Juarez, it's like if you want to kill a person and get away with a crime, do it in Juarez. It's incredible to me, because that's how politics works. I mean, you can see the same area divided by a border. One is the safest place in the U.S. and one is the capital.
It is extraordinary. I think El Paso is the second safest city of its size.
Yeah, and
largely because
the
narcos, they don't want to draw heat on the border. I mean, it goes to Phoenix, it goes to Atlanta.
Right, but they don't kill on the other side of the border because they know that.
But the question that, you know, that sort of, you know, the foreign reporters who come in, and your answer earlier when we were talking to my editor, you know, who's doing all this killing? Thousands and thousands of people, most of them addicts trying to kick the habit in a rehab clinic, poor people, and so on. Who's doing the killing?
We don't know. The legal impunity, the official narrative since the beginning was they are killing among each other. They are all criminals. I mean, you had this, the head of the Ministry of Interior saying this in television. Yeah, they are killing among themselves. It's just criminals. Like, how can you say that? I mean, murder is illegal. You cannot accept that narrative. And my goal since the beginning was to challenge and deconstruct that narrative by asking, how do you know they are criminals? Where is the evidence? Who killed them? Why? We don't know. There is no prosecution at all. So this narrative is at least based in nothing. There is no evidence to support this. So I asked for statistics, for instance, of 3,000 killings. How many victims were armed when they got killed? The statistic is like 2%. So they were all unarmed when they got killed. So how you can stand that they are criminals? And even if they are criminals, like drug dealers or drug traffickers, we as a society, we cannot accept the idea that these people is getting killed among each other, and okay, it's not my problem. And I think that that worked very well for the government. And that narrative pushes away from the, made us believe that we were safe and it was not our problem until we had like 100,000 killings. We started to ask ourselves, are they just criminals? I mean, my brother was not a criminal. Until your family was touched, you started to challenge that narrative. But the level of impunity, that's why I still believe that this book is still vigente, telling.
It's very relevant.
Relevant. Yeah.
Because the level of impunity in the country is 97%, and we don't know who's killing the people, we don't know why, so that avoids you.
It's the vino rosso. One of the nightmares of this is there is no recourse. Who do you go to? The police.
Right.
They're part of the problem. There's a hollow joke, and it's true that if you call the helpline, the kidnapping helpline, you're very often talking to the kidnappers.
Yeah.
09 something, I think it was. Can you talk just a little bit about this kind of nexus? Army, state police, municipal police, cartel, organized crime. No one quite knows where the lines are or are not, or where the chains of command are or are not, but there's a nexus.
I remember once I had a friend who lost her car. Their car was stalled in one parking lot. And she called the head of the police and she said, that was my car. And you know what happened? They got the car immediately. So how do you know who stole the car? Because they control the crime. I mean, there is a tiny example, but multiply that to, if you don't investigate crime, it might be either because you're involved or because you are protected. But it's not because they don't know how to investigate.
And this goes right to the top. Chapo Guzman did not, the tunnel was drilled up into the shower, not down from
right.
the shower. So it's not just a question of the stolen cars, it's a question of him not lasting very long in jail.
Right.
Escape or release, what's the difference?
Yeah. Well, I have this interview in the last chapter of the book with the state attorney, asking him...
But this is exclusive to the English edition, I believe, is it not?
Ask him, okay, we're supposed to have two groups fighting. One group is almost eliminated, arrested, killed, etc. But there is another group.
The Juarez cartel.
The Sinaloa cartel.
Yes,
the structure of the Sinaloa cartel in Juarez. And the police in El Paso, the FBI, released an indictment saying, is this and this and this guy. And he, with names and positions, and all of them, 11 of them, were former police officers of 20 people. Former police officers working for the Sinaloa cartel. And I asked him, what are you doing about this? And he said, I don't prosecute organized crime. This is not my business. And I said, but they are out there. They might be guilty of some killings. He said, of course they are out there. Of course they're still trafficking. Do you think that the drug business is gonna stop? No. I mean, we should be away from the border. We should be like in Finland, in front of Finland, not in front of the US, in order to stop the drug trafficking. So is that tolerated? And he said, but they are not extorting people. They are not kidnapping as La Línea, the Juarez cartel. They are like just traffickers. Like, seriously, it's like that level of impunity. I don't know if this makes sense, but for me, it was really striking to hear that answer. I'm looking to the other side.
Senselessness makes absolute sense. Yes,
absolutely.
In this room. Thank you. I think we must talk about your work and your colleagues and the newspaper. And this isn't kind of media navel gazing in Mexico. There's a wonderful man called Mike O'Connor, who was one of my favorite people in the world, died recently. and he was the Committee for the Protection of Journalists representative in Mexico City, but he didn't sit around. He was proactive and a refuge and a rescue line for many terrified people. Just to give some idea. I mean, you're working on the local paper. You may find yourself accepting money that you didn't ask for. You may find that you're being told that you to write this and this, but not that. And we know where your kids go to school. And you do it. Now, you may not think of yourself as, quote, working for the cartel, unquote, but the other cartel will certainly think of you as that. These people live in this nightmare. Mike made this point that discussion of the mass murder of reporters like Armando and the others in Mexico is crucial to the strategy, whether it's the military or the police or the cartels or all of the above. As you take territory and you establish command of territory, the first thing you do is to control the people with guns, namely the police and the local army commander and so on. The second thing you do is that you control the politicians who supposedly administer the people with guns. But the third thing you have to do is to control the people who might discuss this in public, basically you and Armando. So do take us through a little bit, I mean, because we're talking generally for the most part. El Diario, what was it like every day in the office? You at one point, your editor put out an open letter. You know, what do you want of us? There was no reply. How did it work day to day? I mean, what was it like after Armando was killed? How did you get up in the morning and go to work after that?
Well, after Armando got killed, It was just the opposite reaction to fear. We were extremely angry and not just sad, but I was really honored to be part of that newsroom because we were mostly women and a lot of my colleagues have family, kids, etc. And all of them were like, we are not going backwards, we are going forward because to honor him. And this was the first year of the violence. And we were committed to keep on writing, and we knew that it was a big, big, big story. I mean, we did what every journalist will have done. Like, this enormous story is dangerous and it's painful, but this is what we're supposed to be, why we're supposed to be reporters. And the war is in our city. We are not going abroad to cover a war. The war came to us. And it was absolutely crazy because we were not trained, of course. We didn't know. I mean, for instance, when the army was deployed, I was covering the army. They were not sending press releases. I was just following them. Like, what are you doing? I mean, how you're treating the people? I was following them, and it was, like, crazy because we didn't have, like, any strategy. We didn't know what we were dealing with. But within the years, we started to, we learned that it was, I mean, we started to think that it was serious and, not that it's just serious, but potentially deadly. And we had conversations like, for instance, I remember a colleague of mine, he said, I just stopped driving my kids to school. And me and my wife, we choose different cars. And I told my wife, if you see that somebody shoot me, don't stop. Keep on driving. Don't stop because they're going to get you as well. And suddenly another guy said, well, I mean, we started to share like our last wills. Like, I don't want, for instance, a friend of mine said, you know, if I got killed, please don't let anybody to open my coffin. It's like, it was like regular conversations, and we were like, this is really crazy. But it was, what else are we gonna do? Is leave the city? I mean, I don't know. We were just like, we have a saying in Spanish, is suppose when you have a boil of water and you hear a map, I mean, the frog inside the water doesn't notice it. That's how, I don't know if I make sense. I'm sorry about this.
No, we're gonna just do one last thing because I do want to make sure we have time for you to ask Sandra things you want to talk about. I hope I'm not spilling the beans. we did agree. Sandra's is now in Mexico City and works for a website called Sin Embargo, which I can't recommend strongly enough. I mean, follow it as often as you can. And is now leading the journalistic inquiries into the recent murder in Mexico City of another colleague and an activist friend of his and other people who were in the apartment, including a cleaner, when they, whoever they are, came for them in the capital. They were in flight from Veracruz State, which is the sort of epicenter of the mass murder of journalism, ironically. But Sandra's working on, and just to sort of change gears slightly, but fundamentally not, on the so-called, to use these repulsive euphemisms of the capitalist market, energy reform in Mexico, which basically means privatizing the Pemex Oil Corporation and yet again prostituting the Mexican economy and the Mexican people to the interests of multinational global capitalism. Forgive my neutral language. Well, it's a rich seam. Most of you probably know what's going on, but those of you who don't, it's basically foreign investment, that most repellent and ubiquitous of phrases in the English language, which invariably means foreign exploitation. Thank you, Sandra. You said it, I didn't, by the way. She said. So we have some of our own friends, Shell, BP, salivating at the, quotes, opportunities in Mexico. It so happens that most of the deep water oil and gas is in territory offshore or under territory controlled by the Zetas, who we haven't mentioned tonight, but that's a kind of insurgent paramilitary cartel that's changed the whole game, I think, as far as we can see. It's hard to imagine capitalists as effective as the narco cartels, as innovative as the cartels, staying out of this bonanza. What on earth is going to happen, Sandra?
That's what I'm so interested in, keep on in Mexico, even when it's crazy. For being a journalist, it's the most wonderful place, because it's so fascinating, so weird, so... And I'm really eager to watch, to track the story, and to see what's going on, if the old companies are going to be established in these territories where the Zetas are. I would like to see how they deal with violence and threats there. And if they do it pretty well, that means something. And if, it's the next chapter of our history.
Well, it is, and it's a fascinating one because,
absolutely.
Because we began talking about the mejilladoras, the assembly plants, the sweatshops, basically the United States having the third world, 20 minutes across the bridge.
Right.
In terms of economy. Here we are again, sort of, in a way, advertising the cheapness of the people. Isn't this the... you were talking about earlier.
Yeah, we were talking yesterday about some story that ran in 2013. There was a guy from Merrill Lynch giving an interview saying there are super extremely good news, people. Mexican wages are now lower than in China. This is great news. Everybody can come. We are so cheap that there's a great opportunity for a business in Mexico. I'm like, we are based, this is another part of the problem, in my opinion, impunity and the economic model based in the idea that the lower the wages, the better the country. You cannot sustain a society based in the idea that if you work 8 hours per day and you make £5 or £10 per day, and if you get killed, nobody cares. If you work, you don't make money. You cannot send the kids to the school. That's Mexico. No wonder why we have this society, this situation, because human life has been...
if it's a loaded question, I don't care. If it sounds like a loaded question, I don't care, because it probably is. Is there not a connection between that sort of this kind of bottom line commodification of people and the meaningless of life, which is what your book is basically about?
Of course. The bottom line is the human life has been really devalued in my country by the economic model, and by the lack of rule of law. If you work, you don't make money. If you get killed, nobody cares. So who is protecting human life? Like, no one. That's why everybody can kill, everybody may think that they can kill. I mean, it's a society that is really devaluing the value of human life.
Well, end of part one. Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you, Ed.
There is another book, actually, it's extraordinary, which, in a way, laid the basis for so much of this conversation. It's called Juarez, Laboratory of Our Future.
Right.
And it was published in, I think, the mid-1990s. And this brings me to a sort of a credit that I must roll, so to speak, another name, because the man who collated the photographs for that book is called Julian Cardona. And it was thanks to him that we met. And when you come up the stairs of this place, and if you got the first issue of the broadsheet we put out, you see this picture of this woman who is pinned to a wall and there's a bullet through her mouth. It's a shocking, and some would say inappropriately shocking, image. It was taken by Julian. I don't know if he knows how much the club has used this photograph. It was on the cover of the hardback of the book I wrote.
Know.
You know, if so, he should, listen, we should encourage him to send his invoice, shouldn't we? So I'd just like to sort of include Julian in the credits for tonight. Not least to say that, you know, just Juarez, it's not all like this. And the last time I saw Sandra until last night was when we were out on the balcony of Julian's house. You had the conviction of his city to actually sort of spend every penny he earned. He was a maquiladora worker when he first arrived from Zacatecas, building his own house. And we were listening to Beethoven's Piano Sonata number 32, opus 111, drinking a bottle of red wine, looking out over the murder capital of the world. You know, these things happen. Now, my friends, questions for Sandra. We've got time. We've got half an hour, and it's usually pretty elastic, depending on your thirst.
Hi, Ed, Sandra. Ross Cullen, a blogger, reporter, TV news producer as well. I've lived in Mexico and reported in Mexico, and I think my question is about levels. Is one of the problems, we have the municipal police, the town police, then we go to the state, the federal police, we've got the army, the politicians, the different levels of the criminal organizations, from petty gangs, the middlemen, the international criminal organizations, and then the people in society down at you described it at the bottom line. How can the state, if it is the state or international actors, ever get a hold on this situation? How can they make sense if there is this tangled cobweb, this tangled mess of all these different actors?
How do they what?
How can they ever organize or make a sense or stop any of this violence with the number
of actors,
number of actors there are,
the levels of
all the different levels of police, all the armed forces, the politicians, all the different levels then in the criminal organizations themselves? How can we make sense? How can the state make sense if it is the state?
What is state? Yeah.
But where will the answer come from if the country is involved in such a tangle, such a cobweb?
It's such a kind of mess.
The idea of the state is what I'm not getting. What state do you mean?
Oh, well, I don't. Maybe not the state, but where will the answer come from? Who can drive the answer if everyone is so intertangled?
I don't know. I mean,
like, where would you see any possible light coming from? What kind of tunnels might have light for us in this situation?
Right, I see. That's the tragedy of the country. There is no light at the end of the tunnel. There is no one single institution in the country that you can trust. I mean, you can ask this to any Mexican. Who do you trust? Maybe the church, maybe journalists, maybe NGOs, but not the police, now not the army.
You made a good point about the judiciary in comparison
to Colombia.
Right,
we were talking recently about, for instance, the Colombians used to say, you know, we were really bad during the 90s, we're still really bad, but there was at least a judicial branch functioning. We don't have that. It's like, that's the super extreme tragedy of the country. It's like there's not any hope that somebody's gonna prosecute crime. I don't know. I certainly don't know what is the solution, but I would say that we may start by prosecuting crime, by prosecuting murders, and solving at least two killings, like two important killings. That will be like a beginning. Like, if they solve, for instance, like recently the case of the Ayotzinapa students, that will be a message that this is not the country that allows people to do this to 43 students. But the message is just the opposite. It's getting worse and worse. I mean, 43 students missing, and after a year, nobody can answer the question that where are they? That is like, we always think that we have seen the worst, but the reality is always telling us that we haven't seen it. And the story of the students is just like, what do we expect? I mean, you can do that in Mexico. It was, there is a lot of government involved in the disappearance, the mayor, and but the army was there. Everybody knew, everybody listened to the report. Yep. Everyone knew that what's going on. And we still don't know where are they. Where are they? I mean, I'm super pessimistic. If we keep on living like this, there is not gonna be any solution anytime soon. I'm sorry if I answered your question. I hope to answer your question.
Is this not a wider problem? Is it not just in Mexico, but in South America? Well, in Latin countries? Is this not a wider issue?
Yeah, I think so. But...
Start a Canary Wharf.
I think so. El Salvador, Honduras, they have this level of impunity as well, of violence.
Is this not part of... not having a society where you can go to the police and you can say what you want and you feel that somebody is going to do something. Surely there's a fear that runs through the whole of society, perhaps in Honduras, perhaps in Mexico, even in southern Italy, southern Spain. Is this not a question of growing up and that becomes the norm?
I don't know the level of impunity in Spain. I don't think it's...
No, people aren't being murdered, but there's a lot of corruption, and that's where it starts.
Right, there is a lot of corruption everywhere. That's what I'm trying to say. There is a lot of crime everywhere. The difference is how do you respond to that? And in my country, at least the response is nothing. I don't know.
Thank you so much, Sandra. I thought I'd give a quick translation of your frog story, first of all, and then have a question related to it. So the frog story is about if you mentioned the frog, right, in the boiling
right,
water.
Right.
So the analogy is if you throw a frog into a pan of boiling water, the frog will dive in right. And it will dive straight out. If you put a frog into a pan of cold water and you slowly start turning up the heat, the frog will stay there until finally it boils to death.
That's what I meant.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Which is a fantastic analogy for many things. We've talked a lot about the various different actors on the large playing field, or you know, the elites who might be involved in all of this horrific violence. But actually, I would like to understand from your perspective, going down much more individually, because in Ciudad Juárez we have seen such horrendous examples of what some people might call supra violence, which obviously is a way to instrumentalizing violence can serve many different objectives, fear often,
right.
Or trying to silence a group of people who may be wanting to speak out. But when you come down, in your opinion, to the individual who comes to perform those acts, and it's not just killing somebody quickly, as Ed mentioned at the beginning, people don't often die quickly in that environment. What compels an individual, what takes somebody on the journey to finally commit those kind of torturous acts in that environment?
From my perspective, is the idea that you can do it. I mean, for instance, the people that is hanging victims from a bridge, that takes time. It's not like super easy. I mean, that takes time to put the person in the message, etc. Because they know that they can do it. That's what I'm sorry for being redundant and insisting. Okay. It's the idea that you can do whatever you want.
But that doesn't explain why.
Why? Or for whatever why? Reason you have. I mean, maybe, as Vicente said, because my father didn't buy me a car, so I decided to kill them. Or because this girl didn't want to be with me, I decided to kill him. Or because we were playing as a case this year in Chihuahua, an awful case of 5 kids playing the kidnappers, kidnap a 6-year-old kid and stab him to death. But they were playing, and they were kids. I mean, you may have whatever reason to be violent, but the idea that you can do it is what I think we have in common, and it's an endemic problem. I mean, we as human, I mean, we might be impulsive and et cetera, but we live in a society that doesn't allow certain behaviors. And if you live in a society that allows you to be whoever you want, I mean, you may we end up doing this, and I really believe that if the state doesn't prosecute crime, it's sending the message that human life is not worth it, and in some way we are internalizing that it's like an object.
And but something very important and interesting has happened. I mean, there's been a qualitative shift. Some people were talking earlier about, you know, yet another exhibition of photographs of the girl on the bridge in Vietnam, the concentration camps in Bosnia, and so on. I was thinking, but this is very 20th century. Where we're at now with the Zetas, and they started this, ISIS to a degree as well, is, you know, we advertise our atrocities. It's not the old thing of you show the other side's atrocities. No, it's we show our decapitations and torture on the internet. It's fun. You can do it too, and it works. People do. It's a recruiting poster.
Actually, if you go to
and it's not that far off internet pornography. Actually, there isn't. I mean, there's a fine line between, you know, what half of, you know, the Bible Belt of America is doing at 3 o'clock in the morning on the internet when the wife's asleep, and what the Zetas are doing for real. I mean, it's kind of, you know, hey, you can do it for real. Why sit around, you know, doing whatever in front of a desk at a computer when you can do it for real? I mean, there is a shift. I think what Susie's talking about is that, you know, there is a kind of a, and I'm sure the Inquisition were very good at it, and I'm sure the Romans were good at it, blah, blah. But I mean, there is a shift here in the kind of violence that right. Your colleagues and your people have been
subjected
to.
Yeah, I certainly don't have to answer to that level of barbaric acts, because one thing is to kill a person because you have, I mean, because it's your business or whatever, but another thing is to cut them in pieces, beheading them, and I mean, I certainly don't know, but my opinion is human life has been devaluated so much that, I mean, we don't react. I mean, there is people out there without a sense of humanity.
Is it serving, or what, you know, how are so many individuals able or wanting to do it in such torturous ways?
I have been asked this before, and again, I certainly don't know why they reach this level of atrocity, but I really believe that after 30 years, not just 10, but 30 years of being this country, this land of organized crime just growing and growing, this land of a country that doesn't pay the people, it's like you just assume that you may do whatever you want. I mean, I really don't know why they reached the level of atrocity. I would love to know. But
that's the question mark at the end of the riptide running through the book.
Right.
Point of information, by the way, for you all, our friend who asked that question returns tomorrow to Iraq, where she's working with refugees in territory recently vacated by ISIS.
Hi. I'm from Mexico. I just want to say thank you very much for two things. One, because you come here to UK to raise the voice. What is happening in Mexico? And also because you are a journalist and you mentioned rightly, to be a journalist in Mexico is, by the government, is like a crime. That shouldn't be, because freedom of expression is a right. But unfortunately, the government doesn't seem in that way. And the other thing, when they mention, what can we do? I think what you're doing is amazing. Amazing because you're raising the voice, because you come here to expose all the crises of human rights. And the other thing, I would like to know, what is your message around the world? Because we need to make sure that this government has to change the strategy, because it's enough about corruption, about impunity, about the crisis of human rights, that is torture, is disappearance, and also is massive of killing, more than 150,000. So it's enough.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Thanks for being here.
What's your message? I mean,
well,
you're in the banking capital of the world. You're in a construction site, the foundations of which are basically cocaine, tax evasion, and.
Well, I wouldn't dare to send a message to the UK. I mean, my message is for Mexican people. It's our responsibility to change the thing. First, it's our duty. It's our problem. I mean, you can blame everyone, but it's our problem. We are keeping that government there. And as long as we don't understand and we don't go to the school, the kids don't go to the school, nobody cares about politics because they are so alienated by poverty and television, it's our duty. I would love to blame the US. They have a lot of responsibility in HBC, et cetera. But it's our country. We are the first people with the duty to do things. I mean, that's what I think.
Is there a lesson from Colombia recently?
I think we should learn to, for instance, they have this process of these trials when they are telling the paramilitaries that if you tell the story, you're gonna have a lower sentence. I think that's, I don't know if it is working for them, but the idea of knowing what's going on, I think, is the beginning. We have to know what happened to us. Who killed the people? Who did this all of this? And because it's like a human need to know what happened. Who killed the people and why? And we don't know. We might imagine, we might guess, but if we don't have justice and prosecution, we're gonna have this gap in our history and just, and I think that no society can be built over these 100,000 killings that remain unsolved. We cannot. We should do something about, it's a matter of justice and rule of law.
Can I ask a question about gender? Are there any women who are involved in the cartels? And do women commit any of the crimes? And are there women judges or lawyers, or women in as politicians?
Yeah,
in the
I think it's
who might make a difference.
Of course, the politics system is built mostly by men, but there are women also involved in the federal attorney now. I mean, she's like a joke. I mean. I don't think it's a matter of gender. It's a matter of society. I don't know.
There is a very interesting observation, which is simply that, you know, when one is in Reynosa, Matamoros, Juarez, these terrifying places, it's invariably women and priests
who are overrepresented in the peace movement and facing down the narcos. And Annabel Hernandez, Lydia Cacho, and now our dear Sandra, you know, what have they got in common?
Actually, you did mention that a lot of the families are broken families, or, you know, they have several children, and then you said that some, when someone is married again, and then they get rid of the children of the first marriage. I mean, that, what does that say about kind of families and love between families?
Did I say that?
Right, I was talking about Libesta Bravo, and the burial of the children.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure if I got your question.
I'm thinking of the position of women in the society, and perhaps in terms of gender equality or education, or the influence of television and the telenovelas, and what values that
I think, for instance,
seen in the telenovelas.
Right, I think in Juarez, for instance, is the capital of mono families, like families leading by just one person, mostly women. And it's, there are a lot of people putting so much pressure on families, saying, you know, okay, this, for instance, I have been told, you know, okay, there is this impunity in this system, but, you know, what about the families? And I just, since I know families, worker families in Juarez, I just think, I think, if you will spend one day with one of these mothers, and knowing that she spent 1 hour commuting, 8 hours at work, and she doesn't have any infrastructure to leave the kids, I mean, you cannot blame them. And there is a lot of people blaming mothers and saying, where are these families? And it's not just a problem of politics, but it's a problem of personal stories. And like, the people is really struggling to put food on the table, and nobody's helping them. And nobody's there to take care of the kids. Nobody's there to, I mean, not even to pay them enough to send the kids to the school. So I think it's a matter, I mean, I think it's politics. It's not a personal. I'm not sure if I answered your question. I mean, but Juarez, the maquiladoras relied since the beginning mostly in feminine labor. And since the 90s or 80s, there were a massive immigration, mostly women working for the factories. And it's when everything started, like, they didn't have anywhere to leave the kids. They don't have any support, not even to use a proper public transportation. If you go to Juarez and you see the city, just the image of the city, the desert, the empty spots, the highways that are built to take the production to the border, but they didn't care to build a fucking sideway for the people to walk. That's how it works. I mean, it's a city built for the capital, not for humans, you know? What
the urbanismo is very important in that regard, actually, because
right.
I mean, the whole public transport system, such as it exists, is simply to do with getting people to work
right.
or getting stuff across the border, be it legal or illegal. And it's actually physically impossible, I think, for some children to get to school in under 2 hours or so, coming back in the dark, because of the fan shape of the city. So you're sort of going into town and out. You can't get to school, and you can't afford to go to school. I mean, is that a,
and
does
if
that
you
address
see
this?
The city just by looking at the urban landscape, I really believe that if you see it, you may. Okay, there is. I mean, it's easy to understand why so much people is getting killed, because there are no public lighting, no sidewalks. The people has to walk on the lots. I mean, on the fields. It's. Indigno is like not human. It's a city built for the capital and the production, not for the people that is supporting this economy. It's totally.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for coming down and again, highlighting this issue. My name is Azar Batty. I'm a community development worker. I have worked in community development in the London for most of my working career. And as I sat and listened to you talk, perhaps naively, I'm thinking to myself, how much scope is there to actually transplant community development approaches?
How much what?
How much scope is there to transplant community development approaches to solving some of the problems that you've mentioned?
Self-organisation within the communities
basically,
around,
I mean,
neighbourhoods,
community
barriers.
Community development is all about building partnerships and sowing what patchy resources you have and actually sewing them together to form a partnership, even if it's on a neighbourhood level.
Right, right.
I'm just sitting here wondering, how much could that work? Or do you think that is a possible approach
forward? Absolutely, absolutely. And actually, that was one of the most relevant discoveries for me in Juarez. It's like, is this such an industrial capital that there is so much, and there are so much problems going on. There is a lot of people trying to do something. It's really amazing. And there are serious people and organizations doing analysis and diagnostics and trying to understand. And I rely on them. I mean, since, for instance, in 2006, there's a magnificent organization trying to keep the kids away from the gangs. And they are fantastic intellectuals, people really committed to help. And since 2006, after the census of 2005, they found out that half of the kids from 15 to 20 are in age to go to middle school, they were dropping. And they found out this and crossed this statistic with kids in gangs, et cetera, and they warned us. You know what, Sandra? To every journalist, there are a lot of kids dropping school and not going to work. They are going to be hired by organized crime. We are seeing this. And this is the people that, I mean, this book is, a lot of my work is based in these organizations that are really, really impressive. But the problem is so big that we cannot, I mean, but it is really important to have them and to see how they try to understand the city. And it's really grassroots movements and, I mean, I think it's really important. It's part of the solution, and what has surprised the country by the level of organizations among the people. Like, we certainly didn't see this in Monterrey, or of course not in Tijuana, not even in Tijuana. I mean, Juarez was, I did a story about how well organized were a lot of people in Juarez, like people in the neighborhoods trying to, for instance, to help the mothers to keep the kids while they were working. They mm-hmm. were, I mean, this was all community work, and they were incredible. And I think I really admire them. They are really important. Mm-hmm. Thank you for asking that.
We're running out of time, so should we take a group of questions together?
Good evening. According to Roberto Saviano and other people, experts or journalists, legalization can be the right response to tackle this problem. I mean, the cartel monopoly and the violence.
The corruption of the institutions.
Do you think that the Mexican government can handle it, can handle this process, and do you think it's the right response?
I think the war on drugs, it's so wrong because there is no way to stop it. I mean, if you, as Chuck Boden wrote it, if you have this product that is producing so much money and is wanted for so much people, I mean, there is no way to stop it. But another of the stories that I wrote in Juarez was trying to challenge this narrative of the effectiveness of the war on drugs. And I gathered a statistic about how many people got killed because overdose in 5 years. And the statistics were 50 people in Juarez die, 52 people die for overdose, for using drugs. How many people got killed because of the war on drugs? Well, 10,000 people. So I don't know if this answers your question. It's like, it's obviously not working. I mean, I don't know what could be the solution, but obviously the prohibition is totally wrong. And for instance, you know, the first cause of death in Mexico is diabetes, caused by the consumption of sugar, of course, in Coca-Cola. We are the first consumers of Coca-Cola. So that's the drug that is really killing Mexicans. And the second cause of death, at least the first cause of death in Juarez, was the homicide. So it's like the war on drugs is not working, and the drug that is really killing the people is being just the last month, the Congress tried to cut the taxes, I mean, to reduce the taxes to Coca-Cola. I was like, no, dude, you have to put it higher because this is really, really killing people. That should be the drug that I will be fighting. Like, I don't know, but I certainly believe. And you have, Washington, D.C., the capital of the country that is sending this war on drugs to the world, they legalized weed. And now we are suffering the consequences of their prohibition. It's like nonsense. To me, it's totally hypocrite. And the result of the prohibition is that the government makes so much money by protecting the business that everything is, has destroyed the idea of institution. And I think the result is just devastating.
Okay. Well, Sandra, I was very lucky to meet you in Juarez during the darkest times of the drug violence. I remember being very scared of going up there. I had to spend 4 days with you and doing a profile of you and following your every day, your every movement for 4 days. And you couldn't understand why we would have to follow you with a camera and like how annoying me and my cameraman were. But you showed us every bit of Juarez, the most horrible, the most violent, the most horrible areas that you used to go to Villas de Salvarcar, where the kids were killed, the right. Massacre. But you also showed us where you and your colleagues went to meet in Sanborns, like with your journalism colleagues, and we met Julian Cardona, and we had a great time and in the middle of all this. So for me as a Mexican journalist living in London, I want to say thank you. And when I see Mexico, like when I heard about the 43 students being killed, I was like, what is that? You know, like, what is going on in my country? And I see you and I see good journalism. That's the solution.
Oh, thank you.
I'm sorry to be so emotional, but sometimes we're like, why do we risk our lives? Like, why did Armando have to be killed, you know? And to see you is like good journalism is a solution. We will change Mexico, but it takes people like you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Oh, pressure. Hi, I was interested because you mentioned that you thought it was very difficult to find a solution and also your comments on big business, HSBC in particular. I was wondering whether you had a perspective on the role of big business and international police or sort of crime legislation to try and stop it, not only through community regeneration, but also through penalizing companies who fund organized crime, which happens obviously all over the world, but there seems to be almost an organized a conspiracy to protect big business because capitalism is, you know, so big. And what for you is the role of big business and legislation around that to prevent the kind of scale of organized crime that has such an effect in Juarez?
Oh, they may start with HSBC. Like, these people accepted once that they were laundering money. It's like, it's not like small thing, it's like enormous, and for me it's like, as you said, it's
staggering.
I cannot understand that they are still like out there, like, and they paid a fine, but it was like 300, I don't know how much, but...
If you talk about the war on drugs versus, you know, not actually taking the obvious step...
Exactly.
Exactly.
In Mexico, there is an enormous industry laundering money. And it's like the U.S. used to release like a list of business that belongs to the Sinaloa cartel, like for instance. And a lot of these business are in Jalisco, the state of Jalisco. And I went there and to look to this business, like, and they operate like normally. Even when they are like really, I mean, they are publicly laundering money. And I went to the federal government and said, what are you gonna do with this business? And I said, you know, the US government used to say that, but it's not necessarily true or a problem. It's like, when El Chapo got arrested, I planned to wait 6 months to see what happened during these 6 months. They didn't seize the money. They didn't arrest anybody else. It's like the war on drugs is a total farce. They don't really want to stop it. They just want to, I mean, it's not what they say it is. Right, yeah. Well.
Right, well, I can't really sum that up. Legalization always comes up. I always wonder if it's all legal. And obviously the war on drugs is a total failure. But who's going to make it? Big Pharma. Do we trust Big Pharma to make and distribute as little of it as possible in the desperate barrios of Honduras, Mexico, the townships of Africa? I don't. I think that's why listening to Sandra and the last question is so important, as well as the passionate contribution beforehand. You know, it's sort of, perhaps this is a matter of political economy more than legality. Because I don't think it really matters in Tegucigalpa whether Pfizer or the Zetas are making the stuff. It still pretty much does the same thing to the wretched people. But I think this political economy thing is crucial. Sandra is gracious enough to sort of not have a message for us because she wants to talk about her own country and people and colleagues and friends. But, as Sandra moves into her next phase with the energy reforms, I refer you to the case of a man called Gilberto Torres, who... Colombian union activist who was trying to protect the rights of his people, village, and the workers in the oil industry. He was kidnapped, tortured. Those with him were mutilated and executed. He got out for complicated reasons. He's now suing BP for and I have to say BP is denying any association with this. They would, wouldn't they? And so this question of impunity does actually affect us. Not only are they out there, as you put it so well, with HSBC, but the chief executive of the bank, I'm merely stating a fact, he denies all knowledge of the detail of what was going on in Mexico, but his punishment as the man at the top, as the captain of the ship, if you like, who in the logic of Italian cruise ships goes to jail, his punishment was to be appointed to the British cabinet as a minister for trade. Well, he certainly knows a lot about trade. So we do have an issue of impunity, which is directly related to that. But we won't go into all that now. This term humbling gets overused, but this is where its currency is apposite. It's humbling to have Sandra here. You know, she is, as I say, and it's in print there. You know, one of the bravest people, the most extraordinary people I've ever met, could ever hope to. We're all lucky in that regard to have her. Not many people come to the Frontline Club and secure rapt attention from the newly elected, estimable leader of the Labour Party and the man who played the saxophone for Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames in the same room. And if you haven't heard of Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames, get to YouTube quickly. Sandra,
thank
muchísimas
you.
Gracias, compañera.
Thank you.
We love you very much.